the Umbrella Corporation. Our business is life itself. This podcast episode is brought to you by nothing.
Try it for free.
Patrick Evan McMillan with us here today. It's very good to
Brother
have you
Goliath
on.
Goliath Flores, yeah. My friend.
It's very good to have you on. I've known you for so many years. Yep. Yeah.
Do I say hi to the audience?
When?
Howdy.
Yeah, man. You can do whatever you want. It's our podcast episode here.
You know? Well, I'm glad to be here. Totally unexpected.
So, do you want to talk about that thing we're talking about? I know I just called you. So, do you want to talk about that thing? Like the thing.
Twitter and the Facebook.
Yeah, because I was telling you about why I started doing this, and I told you that.
Yeah.
I'm not crazy about traditional media and having corporations of that magnitude all over.
Yeah, because I didn't even know that you were doing this type of thing.
Yeah, because I'm not on Facebook. Nobody knows anything about me.
How is a musician not on Facebook these days?
It's crazy, huh?
Yeah, it is kind of crazy.
So I was telling you that, you know, when you're on that website as a musician, you know, venues that you play at, you know, they check up on you to see if you're advertising your gig and their business, you know? Yep. And, you know, I don't have a good feeling about that, like when I have to advertise my gig like that. One of the reasons that I'm not famous, not that I should be, but is because of that. Cause I don't,
you should be,
you know, I went to, out to Oakland and California out there, and out there, you gotta be a mover and a shaker. You gotta be selling your CDs.
I remember when you were out there.
Yeah. You gotta be selling your CDs. I met some interesting people but if you're not like that, it's just like the rent is high out there.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and I just,
you're
didn't
saying have, if you are not moving and shaking, and
I heard New York's like that too.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So if you're not out there and like, yeah, man, come on my show or like buy my CD. I don't know exactly. I don't even know how to imitate it because I don't know how to do it.
Right.
You know.
Yeah, exactly. It's called shameless self-promotion.
Yeah. Yeah.
Shameless self-promotion.
Yeah, and I'm just not into it.
Not either. Let me tell you, Brother G. Mm-hmm. I noticed that the people like yourself, who should like have been on Jimmy Fallon or something by now, right? Those kinds of people who are more brilliant, I should say.
Thank you.
Yeah, man.
Sweet.
And I know a lot of people would agree with me, mm-hmm. you know, but sometimes those people are not putting the work in. The people that I know that are not the best singers, that don't have the best production on their demos and things like that, they have EPK, you know, these things you send all, you see, I can't even say it. I'm like, you know, these are digital web that they have their electronic press kit.
Yeah.
They have their portfolios, Brother G. They are taking trips now to music festivals in Miami. They buy plane tickets to go to New York. These are the people that don't have the same type of artistic gifts as people like yourself and some other people I could name, right? Mm-hmm. So it seems like it's a more of a dire situation if the person feels less talented. They advertise themselves more because they feel like they have to. And then the people I know that really got it going on, they're like, oh, I don't have an EPK. Oh, I'm not going down no festival down there to promote nothing. I'm not stopping anybody on the street and asking them if they can listen to my CD. And you know, so that's why you're not doing it, because you have a greater gift.
Well, you know.
Your gift is not marketing, it's art.
You know, for some time I felt guilty for not marketing it, because I did do it at first for a few years, You know, and then I was just like, just can't do this anymore. Mm. I just can't do it anymore.
Yeah, yeah, man.
You know, and I was doing some really creative work. A lot of my creative energy was going to making flyers and the design of the flyers and whatnot. And I felt like this goes hand in hand with social media too, but towards the tail end of my tango with those very involved social media sites is that I felt like I was going walking around everybody asking them to love me. You know,
yeah, that's what hey, will it feels
you love
like.
Me? Will you love me? Come on over here and love me, you know. And I'm just like, you know, part of me was like, man, fuck you. I don't need you to love me.
But that's I don't. What it feels so, like.
You know, yeah, that's what it's
pay
kind
me
of,
some attention.
Uh-huh. You know acknowledge me, you know. And I just couldn't believe it. I'm like, I can't believe I'm in this position in life, you know. Mm. And then, you know, so, you know, I asked myself, I'm like, okay, Goliath, so is this... is this ego driven? Is this like because you think that you're too good for this? Mm. You know, and it's like, no, it's just that I think that I'm good. Like I think that I'm a good person. I'm a good spirit. I'm a good soul and I have good intentions. And it seems like when you go to that place too often, like whatchamacallit, when I go to that place, there's always somebody who walks up and tries to knock me down from there because you're not supposed to think that you're good. Like maybe it's some sort of Catholic Christian thing that comes from way back that you're supposed to think that you're a sinner. You know,
you're Catholic too?
I grew up Catholic.
I grew up Catholic.
Yeah, I grew up Catholic. And but I'm not now.
I know, you know? I understand.
Yeah, and
we're citizens of the universe now.
Exactly. Absolutely. See, took the words right out of my mouth. Yeah.
Yeah, right on. No, it is it's ego driven, but it's not like bad ego. It's like it's almost like saying if you love me, if you're dancing in front of me, if you enjoy it, like you know, I don't want to have to ask somebody to buy a CD. I want to put the CDs in front of the stage, and if you like them, please come and get a CD. I am not one of these people that's like after every song I'm holding up my CD. I got CDs for $10 because if nobody comes, it hurts your feelings. Mm-hmm. And sometimes nobody will walk up there and get a CD. And it hurts your feelings. So that's why I say a lot of it is ego driven. But it's not for a bad reason. You just feel like, wow, you're dancing. You're here. You're telling me you're enjoying it. But you're not supporting the art part of it. And so I guess what you said earlier, ego driven.
Financially, they're not supposed to.
Yeah, you know. And the clubs, listen, it's two different pays. It's what a club pays a musician to come, and it's what a club pays a promoter to promote. Now, if they're getting on our case because they didn't see us put enough about it on Facebook, we're not getting paid as promoters.
Exactly.
That's a whole nother pay. Mm-hmm. That's a whole nother job.
Not anymore. Hey. They like it like that.
Yeah, well, I don't think that's cool at all. It, when you leave this level, we wish like bars and stuff like that, and we do restaurants, weddings, and things like that. You know, Madison Square Garden is not expecting the Rolling Stones to, the band themselves to be out there dropping flyers and on the street, handing flyers out to people. Mick Jagger ain't handing flyers out to people on the street talking about come to my show tonight.
Yeah, that shit would probably work though, right?
Mick Jagger, of course.
And Mick Jagger standing on the side of the freeway.
That would come be to my awesome. Show.
I just saw Mick Jagger on the side of the freeway.
That would be awesome.
No, you didn't.
So I you did know. Too. So that's what I think it is. They don't realize that. And because I have worked in the promotion side and the music side, like when I was singing and years ago, I was in a band called the Big Band Theory, and I was in Aerial Tribe, and we promoted. We were putting flyers out. We had a street team that we, the band, were the street team. Mm-hmm. You know,
that's beautiful.
It was fantastic, and there were magnificent results. Mm-hmm. Now these days they say only like 1-2% of people come to a gig because they saw a flyer. Mm-hmm. They say flyers are not the thing that's getting people to gigs. So what is?
Well, that's always been the case with flyering, though.
Okay.
Was like one. I think maybe it was 10%. I don't know the exact number, but I know it was small.
Yeah, man.
Most of them just go in the trash.
Yeah.
Yeah. And when I was promoting, when I used to promote strongly around town, I used to do it digitally, digital flyers through emails.
Okay.
You know, and whatever, I would upload it to somewhere and send somebody an image link, you know, that kind of thing. Because I didn't believe in, like, I'm printing all this paper just to throw in the trash can.
Yeah.
You know, it's like,
and what about this? What about when you're riding your bike and you see what your flyers on the ground? Like, you've been flying cars all night long, and then you get up and you're riding your bike through Riverside and you see your flyers on the ground, which means people came out of the club and said, "What is this?" And oh my God.
Yeah.
That's more ego stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, it's never happened to me. It's never happened to me. I would have to look at the people's trash box on the email. Oh. Trash.
No, it's a drag. You can see where people stepped all over your face and tire tracks all over your face. Your flyer sitting in the water is a picture of you just over about to go down in a drain because it's been raining.
All these roles have condensed. The agent, the graphic designer, the web master, the person who's taking care of promotions is all supposed to be one person now. If you're a solo artist, that is, you know.
Yeah.
If you're in a band, at least you got a team if you're working together like that, you know. But if you're working together like that. But, you know, I was like, yeah, I'm not going to do this. I can't do this. You know, I can barely practice the guitar and play the guitar at the level that I'm playing the guitar. And, you know, make that happen and gig at the same time and take care of the things I need to take care of in my life.
Right.
You know.
Oh, I have a question.
Yeah.
Okay. Speaking of which, because you said if you have a band like that, and like I said, I've been in two, Aerial Tribe and a Big Band Theory with Karan. Mm-hmm. Marcellus, and now we did that promotion thing, but I've been in seven bands, so that's two bands out of seven that I've had that kind of. What do you think? Like, the people you hire, I don't want to get you in no trouble and then like that, but okay. I know that you have to hire, you are the booker. Mm-hmm. You are the contractor. Yeah. Just like myself, we call musicians and say, can you do this? We pay the musician. How often has a musician that you hire called you and said, Brother G, I got a gig for us tonight?
Man, okay, so that happens 10% of the time.
10%?
Like if we're talking about the gigs that I get, 10% of the time somebody calls me and says,
I'm talking about somebody in your band.
Yeah, yeah, in my band or somebody that I know that I've played music with before.
Okay.
Yeah, it's like 100% of the gigs that I do, 10% of those gigs came from somebody else.
Well, that's still right?
Yeah,
Small amount. Mine ain't 10%.
Yeah.
You know,
I think it's less, but I'm being generous.
You are being generous. Yeah. You don't want no trouble.
No. I mean, because I could forget. I could forget about some, you know.
Yeah. No, they depend on the people that's doing the booking, like yourself, like myself, to do the booking. I will even ask musicians sometimes, oh, you working with so-and-so tonight. Find out who does the booking at that club. I will call them, you know, but just find out, you know, what's the deal, who's the manager, who's the book. Never. Not even once.
They don't.
Not even once.
You mean they won't call?
The musicians that I hire that I hire regularly, that are working with other people from time to time, and I'll say, oh, yeah, we'll find out who's doing the booking. I'll call and see if maybe we can get in there on another night. They just don't. Like, they don't want to. They want to. It's a hustle that we're in. Mm-hmm. And so they just want to show up and just show up. You know, they don't want to like help the night. That, you know, I don't see there being like a group. Like, I just see a bunch of subcontractors. I'm the contractor. You're a subcontractor. You come and play guitar. You come and play drums. You come and play bass. Mm. Nobody ever gets on the phone. Mm. It's a drag.
Yeah.
You know, like, wow, think of how much more we could be working if the four of us were calling people every day. It's a drag.
Yeah, and it's I think it's personality type, but it doesn't have to be a natural personality type. It could be by force, like meaning that I've called myself many times in the past an introvert that is forced to be in the position of an extrovert because of what I do for a living.
Right.
You know, but really, I feel like an introvert.
Me too.
You know, but you're an introvert, but you're on stage.
I know.
You know what I mean? So it's a weird thing.
That's
it's like
a weird thing. Yeah. And people don't understand.
Yeah. So that's where you can share your art. You know, if you could do it a different way where it was more private, I guarantee you'd probably take that route.
Oh, please. I would like to do shows with a black curtain in front of me where you just, a light was behind me. You can see my silhouette. Oh, yeah. I'd be so much more comfortable. Are you kidding?
That would be your name, Silhouette.
Oh, I love that.
You can do it. Silhouette. I don't know who it is. Silhouette.
Yeah, I don't know how an introvert now like
I'm going to have to delete this part if you do it. That way they'll know, because then people will know.
Right, exactly.
You're like, hey, Goliath, can you please delete that video?
Funny. Yeah. No, it's deep being shy and doing what we do. People don't believe that you are shy or that I am shy. There are times I go after every break and I just run out. Hey, cutie pie.
See, my daughter, this happens in podcasts from time to time. It's a beautiful thing.
That's awesome.
You know, it represents life right here. Don't step on these things. Thank you.
No, I told that there was a musician once. We were in Asheville, right? Hey.
Where's this baby? She's eating a digestive. She's eating a digestive cracker. All right, thank you.
I went to, Aerial Tribe, we were once doing a show. Bye, baby. We were doing a show in Asheville. And during every break, I would go and sit in the car or in the van. And the drummer, who wasn't our regular drummer, he was like, are you feeling okay? And I was like, yeah. He said, because every single time we go on break, I see you go and run and jump in the van by yourself. And I said, that's because I'm anxious about talking to people. And he was like, really? I said, absolutely. I'm not anxious to sing for people. Mm-hmm. I'm already anxious to sing for people. But after I'm not singing, I'm running out back of the building. I'm jumping in a car. And if the gig is close enough to my house, I'm actually riding my bike home and telling one of the band members to call me when it's almost time to go back on. You know, just that's to great. be out for a minute, you know. And anybody that knows me well is coming too. You know what I'm saying? But not just like everybody. I love the people. I always say, Brother Goliath, I could give a million hugs a day. I could not talk to a million people a day. We could just see each other. We're going to keep it moving, you know. But the talking part, I don't know. I'm just more shy than people think.
Well, you know, there's also the element that you have to rest because you've been talking. Absolutely. You've been singing the whole time.
Absolutely.
Right? And there's two things I don't want to do on my break. The way I play the guitar, I have to sit. Two things I don't want to do on my break is sit and talk. I don't want to talk to people. You know?
I understand.
And
that sounds weird, doesn't it?
Well, I mean, here comes the mover and the shaker part, right? Because you're supposed to go out there and be like, but then you would probably be a shitty singer anyway, so it wouldn't matter if you ruined your voice. Just go out there and keep talking, you know.
I used to do it. I used to do it. But what I started realizing that it was making me more anxious because I was doing it. You hear me, brother? I would get off stage at anybody I had seen tapping their feet while I was singing. I would go over and say, thank you for being here, and shake their hand and stuff. Brother G, over about a couple of years of doing that, I had met so many people that it was impossible to like be anywhere without somebody going, hey, and calling you over and stuff. And I'm like, oh my God, you know, they don't know me like that. I don't talk like that. It was advice from another musician that I was doing that, you know, who had been doing this part before me. And he said, Pat, his name is Steve McDowell. He used to be in the Cosmic Pimps. So my first lead gig here, which was back in like 97, I called him up. I said, Steve, I said, you got to come over. I got to talk to you. So he comes over to my house. I said, I'm doing my first gig tomorrow with my band. It was a Vibe Element at the time. I said, I don't know what to do. I said, I'm so nervous. He said, keep your eyes open. And he said, and when you see people that are enjoying it, go and say, what's up? And it worked out so well socially, like as far as the love and stuff. But I met so many people. I was, you know, you felt like you're running from folks sometimes. Like, oh my God, you know, you walk in a place and you're saying hi to like 12 people that you don't know. You haven't even saw your friends yet. Uh-huh. It's like 12 people that you've encountered at socially. And they'll come in and everybody's drinking. And
yeah, you ever think about that?
Yeah, it's weird.
Yeah, you ever think about that on a global scale?
Oh, God. But see, they got...
I mean, you ever think about that? Like, you, there's nowhere on the globe you can go and get away from that?
I couldn't even imagine it. But they have corporate behind them. As a matter of fact, I've had that thought. I've been like, wow. I said, I'm getting this love in my hometown. Mm-hmm. Imagine if... When I went to Dubai and I go to LA and it's
Korea,
the same thing. But
Japan.
They have bodyguards and they have a green room and a nice limo you're getting into. You know, it, you don't have that access. You got to have a backstage pass to get back there where they are. If they're on the, a lot of times the restaurants and stuff that these people go to are way outside of the price range of the normal fan would even be able to go to. You know what I'm saying? So they put themselves in a position.
Yeah, I've looked through those windows before.
I looked through them. I've been in some of them, I must say. You know
what I'm saying? It's a nice restaurant there.
Wow, like that looks good. What
I said hi to Julian Lennon one time through the restaurant window.
Oh, did you really?
Yeah, I saw
did he wave back?
There. Yeah. No, he didn't wave back. He went.
Okay.
He just nodded his head down like this.
Just like his dad.
He acknowledged it. He just went. You know, I was always real. I'm always really chill with celebrities. Though,
me too.
You know, I grew up. You grew up around celebrities, or you were exposed to a lot of them, and being around them. And you are one. You know, like we're talking about, you're a local celebrity in your hometown. You know, but people who have that, like, let's say, national thing, over. In LA, I would run into them so often that it became a thing like, oh, I see they're all just people now. Because I would run into them at the jewelry store, you know what I mean? And at the hippie shop and at the hamburger place and at the ATM.
They're like, you're that musician. I love what you're doing.
Yeah, yeah. And it didn't take me long. I'm a pretty perceptive person. It didn't take me long for me to see that if I was with somebody and they were more determined to get their autograph, it didn't take me long to realize that I'm bothering this person right now.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
You know, and I really like this thing that Aziz Ansari says, that he says he loves black people, especially in New York. He goes, why? He goes, because everywhere else people bother me. They call me over their table. I'm walking past a black man in New York, and he goes, and they see me and they recognize me and they go,
oh, right.
And they keep walking.
They'd be like, hey, right on. Right on. Yeah. You know?
So I wanted to be like love that. You. I wanted to be like that more. Yeah, I just wanted to, hey, I love you.
Yeah.
They probably don't even want to hear that. I don't know. You know. But you gotta love the praise a little bit. You know, you gotta love the people. If you're somebody who's doing something for the masses. You know, you can't you can't get rid of that part of it.
Right.
You know, and, you know, when you were going out to your car, I guarantee you there was some dude or some chick going, that dude's an asshole.
Something.
like people have misinterpreted my reclusiveness when it comes to that break time or whatnot to being an asshole.
I received that.
You know, and he thinks he's too good, or he doesn't want to talk to anybody, or, you know.
It's not like
well,
that.
Like somebody who I got to know after I played at a certain gig in St. Augustine, they asked me about that, and he told me, yeah, bro, I thought you were an asshole, actually, because of that. And I said, no, man, I was depressed.
Yeah, see?
I didn't want to talk to anybody.
Absolutely.
You know, that's my baby crying in the background.
You're beautiful, baby.
Yeah, I don't know what's wrong with her right now.
Because she wants to come here with us. She's trying to kick it. But you know, it's okay. The thing is with you and people, and with me and people, the people that don't know you don't know what an intellect you are and what a intellectual thinker and a spiritual thinker. She's agreeing. You know, what an intellectual thinker. What a provocative thinker and conversationalist. So they're not going to get that from you in that 10-minute break.
No way.
And you know that too.
Yeah.
So you're just like, okay, if some circumstances bring us together or one day, you know, we get to have a conversation, then they'll see it different. it's probably not going to happen on our 15-minute break, especially when you're trying to rest your voice, mm-hmm. have a smoke, whatever.
If you want to hang out with me, like, you know what you should do on my break? Is why don't you give me a shoulder massage right now?
Okay. You said that'll keep my attention. Right.
If you want to be cool to me, just give me a shoulder massage right now, please.
Yeah. And we really only have to talk.
Yeah, just rub my shoulders for a minute. I'll listen to whatever you have to say.
Yeah.
I'll listen to that. So my cousin played guitar for a long time. I'm like, uh-huh. We're like, yeah. My cousin played guitar. I was like, okay. You know, there's things that people, their fans talk about repeatedly, and they don't realize that they do it because they don't hear it. Like, you're in the position where people are hearing it. Where right. you're hearing the repetitions.
Right.
People tell you that they used to play an instrument. People tell you that about somebody in their family that plays an instrument.
Yep.
You know, and then you got the questions. If you gig a lot and you got to, like, do a lot of PR, then you have the situation where you're answering the same question over and over again. Where are you from? How long you been playing?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know? And then you start getting tired of that, you know. And then you want to just wear a badge t-shirt that says all the information right here.
Yeah. Because a lot of times we don't know. Like, they might be like, it's Friday. Where are you playing next weekend? I'm like, I don't know. You know, I have to go ahead and check my calendar. I don't know. Like, I don't just know like that, you know. Mm-hmm. So, no, I see what you're saying. And, you know, your friends
like you.
Don't come
I'm
up
just
on
just like
you
like that. No. I don't know what I'm doing tomorrow.
What's today? What is today?
What
it's Monday,
blessed,
yeah.
What a blessed life.
Yeah.
Some people know exactly what day it is.
Not me.
Some people know exactly what day it is every day.
I don't.
Today is Monday.
I do not.
Thank God it's Friday.
I do not. No, and a lot of artists that I have this friend, he's a visual artist in town, Overstreet Ducasse, right? And this man called me up. He was like, "Pat, I just had the weirdest experience." He said, "I was driving down around the Riverside." He said, "And I kept seeing all these cars in these parking lots, right?" And he was like, "What is going on?" Like, you know, he was like, is this like a holiday? Like, is there some big event in Riverside?" He said, "It finally hit him." He said, "Oh my God, it's Sunday. These people are in church." He didn't even know it was Sunday. He was like, could not figure out why all these cars were at all these parking lots. Mm. So that's the mind of the artistic people I know.
Mm-hmm.
Don't know what day it is. Don't know what time. We live by the gig. We have a gig tonight.
Yeah.
That's how I know it's
See,
like
Monday,
you know
Monica Da Silva? She sings the Brazilian music.
Oh, Monica, yeah. I've heard of her. We don't know each other.
Yeah, I was
I've
talking to her. She's pretty deep, too. She's a pretty deep person, too. And I was talking to her about gigging. And, you know, she mentioned something that I've thought many times, and I've mentioned it before, too, is that, and I'm sure you've thought this, too, or you've felt this, too, is that when you have a gig tonight, you have to kind of take it easy all day.
Absolutely.
Because people don't realize how much energy it takes
Absolutely.
Out of you. And I can't say it enough times how much energy. They see you up there doing your thing, smiling, mm-hmm. enjoying yourself, or it looks easy what you're doing.
Right.
You know, but this is athletics.
Right.
You know,
and you're tired because you're breathing.
Yeah.
Breathing. Yeah. You know,
now, if you're sitting on a stool playing the electric bass through an amp, that might be a little bit different.
Okay.
If you're just playing the bass,
okay.
You're not dancing around and you're not singing back up, you know, and you're not really, you're just doing the, you know, and that's a little bit different. But if you're lead singing, if you're singing, you're doing athletics.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do we have a guest again?
A little guest? Yes.
Hey, baby, can I have some water, please? I'm thirsty over here. Them falafel is salty. Did we already talk about Wally's? They're not even paying me. I want to plug them because they're
okay,
so good.
Okay, what kind of food is it?
It's a Mediterranean food. It's Middle Eastern food.
Okay.
And they're Muslim who own it, and they're religious. Which it would be like the equivalent of if they were Jewish, their food would be kosher.
Gotcha.
So they call it halal.
Halal.
Yeah, which means that they have to kill an animal a certain way if you're going to eat meat.
Oh, right on.
Like, it has to be humane. You have to feed it certain food, and you have to, like, and the religion, you could taste it in their food.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, you know their kitchen is clean, and you know that like their tomatoes are red.
Mm-hmm.
Gotcha. And I've noticed that if they're lacking in something, if something is not right, they won't serve it to you. Like one time it happened to me with tabbouleh. And I said, I asked for tabbouleh and it was like off hours, like between lunch and dinner or something like that. And then they said, no, you don't want it right now.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I appreciate that. Don't give me any like old tabbouleh. Yes.
That's not every restaurant.
No. If you're a restaurant, why would you even do that to your customer? Like feed them some like food that's like fermenting.
Right.
It's like just to try to make some money off of them.
Yeah, exactly.
Hi, baby. She's very present in this podcast.
Oh, awesome. Bye-bye. But that's when you know there's a spiritual element involved. If somebody is actually not going to serve you something, or like you said, preparing food, feeding them certain things. And
yeah, I appreciate your patience with the babies.
You have to turn me onto these plates. Uh-huh. I don't be having flow to be going to restaurants.
Yeah, we got to go to this place sometime.
Yeah, when I have 2 gigs, not one, in a week.
Yeah.
So how are your schedule going? Right now is very slow. So if I was making a lot of money on the one, I wouldn't care. You know, but right now, like, my main gig over the last like 2 months has been like at my place, Bar and Grill in Bay Meadows.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like every Monday night, right? With Jeremy King, who's the lead singer and the saxophonist of Fat Cactus.
Mm-hmm.
And this guitar player, Eric Heron. So we do a trio. And then the universe, you know how it is. You think you're off on the weekend, and then you get these pop-up gigs, and you're not off on the weekend. You know, you got gigs, and you didn't realize it. And so that works out good. But, Brother Goliath, I have not been actively. I'm in a place right now where I'm just like, listen, I'm going to make this Monday night gig. I'm just going to have to make this flow stretch through the week because I don't have a manager. I don't have a booking agent. I don't have a band that's helping me. And so I have not been feeling like I'm having a mental shutdown right now as far as like feeling like getting on the phone calling people. I just don't feel like it.
It's hard, man. So you know how we're talking about a little bit earlier, the other members, band members don't want to do it.
Yeah.
You know, it's a scary thing to do if you've never done it before.
Yeah.
Let's say you play the guitar, and let's say you're even good. You play the guitar and you're singing, you're a one person act, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you're decent, let's say you sound really good, it's still scary. Because what do you say? And who do you talk to? And how do you approach them? And what does it even look like? Do I call them first? And then do I show up with my guitar and show them something like some sort of vagabond? You know?
That works better than, let me tell you, I got a friend, Bert Mingy, fantastic guitar player and great singer. Right? He lives in Boston now. Bert and I would be like, listen, we ain't got no money. And Oscar Barnett and I would do the same thing. As a matter of fact, they're in-laws now.
Mm-hmm.
Oscar married his sister, Anna. Mm-hmm. But we would be like, listen, we want to go play at so-and-so for an hour just to show them, because we don't have a demo.
Mm-hmm.
So why don't we tell them we'll go and play for an hour, and then, you know, whatever tips we get, we'll get. That has never not worked for me. Single time has that ever, at the club, ever not hired me if me and a guitar player did that.
Yeah.
I have more success doing that than calling them up going, this is Patrick Evan. I've been playing in town for 150 years.
Aging like 20 years ago.
Right. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, 150 years I've been playing here, you know. Don't let this fool you. You know.
And he drinks blood. Patrick Aaron drinks blood at night.
Yeah,
that's what he's doing. That's what he's doing on his break in the car.
Exactly. So, you know. But I'm open to do more of that.
Mm-hmm.
I am open. And like, I know musicians don't like to do that. Thank God Oscar would do it. Thank God Bert would do it. You know, because
they would make the call. You mean
I would make the call?
Yeah, yeah. And they would go ahead and do the demo thing, the live demo.
We would do a live demo.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I'm still open to that. As a matter of fact, if I had the commitment with that, That is how I would book every single one of my gigs. I said, we'll come on one of your off nights and just mm-hmm. play for the bar manager or who's ever doing the booking mm-hmm. a set. I know what it is. The musicians, of course, you know, will be saying like, "Derek, we got to come set up. I got to bring this PA because I'm always very blessed with people who will bring their PA because I don't have one. Mm-hmm. I do the booking, they bring the PA, so we yeah. you know, wound up being like a team. But most people don't like doing it. But if this can be any advice to some musicians out there that are trying to break in, if I had it my way, I would be doing live demos every time, and trust me, I'd be working a whole hell of a lot more.
Mm-hmm. Now, I used to have a situation where I was working, I would work sometimes 7 days a week. For sure, six. Oh, no, God. I was doing that, right? So, and like you said, I don't want to do that. I got burned out mm-hmm. real bad.
Yeah.
You know, and I was just, I got to the point where, you know, if I play guitar a certain way too many nights in a row, my muscles swell up in a way that I can't make certain minor movements easily anymore. You know, because it takes a certain type of finesse muscle. Like I could never be a bodybuilder and get my hands, anyway, I don't think so, and get my hands all in a certain way if I'm going to play the guitar the way that I want to play the guitar. Because I need to develop these other muscles.
Okay.
You know? So those muscles, I noticed that my hand gets it'll get swollen, not like arthritic, but like muscularly. And I'm like, yeah, I can hit the shit out of the guitar, but I can't do this tiny movement anymore.
What?
Yeah, something about it. It's just like you just can't. There's a sweet spot of keeping yourself warmed up with your instrument, and if you overplay, you start damaging. Like you start hurting. You start getting sore. You know, if you oversing, certain notes they're going to be gone.
Yeah,
you're
getting hoarse.
Yeah, exactly. And it's the same thing. Same thing with your fingers. Same thing with your shoulders, your arms, you know.
And, 7 days a week. That's the kind of stuff me and Ariel Tribe and Cookie Bush and Vibe Element. And, you know, I don't like it. It's like almost like I would rather live just above being a bag mm-hmm. of a bag of
wine. I've done that too, by the way. The live thing when I was starting out.
Doing 7 days a week?
No. I went to the place and played guitar for them.
And you had success, I bet.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I got hired. Nothing better than that. I'm telling you, God goes.
Because if you sound good in front of me, that exactly. What else is there to it? You know. Listen,
mm-hmm. I believe that the universe, the creator, is going to send me that person again that would do that type of thing with me. Might be a full band, I don't know, but at least a guitar player, because there's a lot of little gigs around for just like a singer and a guitar player. Mm-hmm. And I know that I'm going to have someone that is going to see the reason for that. It's only an hour. You know, we're just going to play one set. You know, mm-hmm. A lot of times these restaurants will feed you if you do that. The ones that don't even feed you when you're playing and when they're paying you. If you come and donate a little live demo, they'll feed you. I don't drink on my gigs anymore, so I don't have to worry about that. So most musicians I work with do. What do you think about that? Like, what do you think about the alcohol? I can say it. Alcohol. Yeah. Uh-huh. What do you think about the alcohol content of musicians on gigs?
I think that I got to bring up, actually, I don't want to name them. But because he might not want to be named right now.
He knows he's a drunk.
But no, he's not. Well, I'm going to tell you right now. Look, the dude is Irish. He's okay. Irish descendants. Okay. And he can put away some whiskeys. Okay. He can put away like 3 or 4 whiskeys on the rocks. Okay. In a gig. And he's still just right as rain, sharp-witted.
Oh, really?
Sharp-witted, on point, on rhythm. No, bass player.
Okay.
The bass player. And he's always been that way, and I'm just in awe of it. Because if I drink 2 beers, I'm like, I just get a little bit slurry.
Yep,
like,
exactly. Uh-huh. I completely understand.
Yeah, but I'll tell you what, concerning alcohol and gigs, though, I don't like being paid in a bar tab.
Yeah, like pay off the whole thing. Oh, you mean like,
Like, oh, here, we'll pay you $100 plus a $50 bar tab.
You're like, no, just pay me $150.
Yeah.
Why can't you do that? I'm because, not going to drink on the gig.
Because,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah, because the bar tab is actually like $15 for them. Like $15 worth of alcohol that the restaurant paid for is like $50 worth of alcohol. Maybe less. Okay. Maybe it's $10.
Probably less.
Yeah.
I bet it's way less.
Yeah, because the markup, the last time that I heard about the markup on the alcohol in a restaurant, the standard was 300%. So if you, whatever, I'm bad at math. But yeah, so if you buy a bottle of wine at $10, then 300%. I'm so embarrassed right now. Oh my God.
I'm not going to even try. I ain't so, even trying. I know so I don't know how to do math.
You're supposed to get... Like, I don't know, I would assume something like if you buy a $10 bottle of alcohol, wine at a restaurant, then you would get, like, let's say $150 out of that bottle.
What? Okay.
No, I don't know. Whatever.
I don't know. You could be right. Because I don't even know. I'm horrible at math.
It's not a secret. It's not a secret. Everybody knows that knows me knows that I suck at math.
Oh, me too.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no, for real.
I'm not ashamed of it. I'm fine with it. And people are like, but Goliath, you're a musician. You're supposed to be good at mathematics.
Oh, yeah, like, yeah, right.
Yeah, that's a myth.
Because music is all math.
It's a myth.
Yeah.
You can apply math to music.
Right.
You can apply it, but it is not math.
I agree.
It is feeling, and it is straight up emotion.
I agree.
You know, that's why you can take somebody like, you ever heard of the King of the One String? Mm-mm. I've mentioned him a couple times on the podcast, but he's worth mentioning because... I think the dude is, I think he lives in Louisiana, but it sounds like he's from Jamaica. Maybe he's in Jamaica, but he plays a one string acoustic guitar with a bass string on it.
Hmm.
And he just makes the most beautiful music on that with his voice too.
Is he blues? Is he a blues singer?
You know, he kind of sounds like a mixture of some old blues and Jimi Hendrix.
Okay.
Right, so if you can imagine Jimi Hendrix with a good voice. Jimmy knew he didn't have a good voice.
I know.
He was like, I wish I could sing.
Yeah. He was shot, very shy too, they say.
Yeah. He knew it. He knew his voice was all right.
He did. Yeah.
You know, because if somebody can't sing, they start doing that.
Little Bob Dylan thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Or like the Metallica thing, if you call that singing. Like, I'm not trying to talk any shit or anything, but the Metallica thing where... I'll never forgive him for this, for starting the whole nation has been doing it for like a decade after Metallica, maybe more, like 20 years, where they do the,
it's a seal.
You know what I'm talking about? That thing?
Yeah, like ending notes like that.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a in a sea.
And then singing up here, back here somewhere.
Yeah.
In a sea. I'm like, what is that tough? Is that like the leather jacket and the helmet and the motorcycle of the rebel in the music industry? You know, that thing.
Does Bruce Springsteen
in white
do
America,
that?
That is anyway.
Does Bruce Springsteen do
no,
that?
No, Bruce Springsteen is just the boss. He just knows. Okay. He's the original boss. You know, Bruce Springsteen is, you know, every once in a while you see. I don't know the guy, but it seems like from everything, like Bruce Springsteen is like a really nice person.
Oh, yeah.
Real down to earth.
I bet.
And super rich and super famous.
Yeah.
You know, and that is rare, man. Like, there's something about certain people where I'm investigating right now. Like, what makes these people stay productive in the sense of, like, for example, if you get too much success and you get too wealthy, you're going to lose perspective with the masses of people because you don't have the same life. You know how we were talking about earlier that certain celebrities get to be in different areas of life or different restaurants because other people can't afford those things.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if that happens for too long and too much, you lose perspective, and then people lose touch with your music because it's not making sense to them anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's why everybody like loved Eddie Murphy at Beverly Hills Cop. Like, 1 and 2, because he was just a regular guy.
Mm-hmm.
He was wearing a hoodie and some jeans.
You're right.
And he was like funny. And then he got famous and more famous and more famous. And then his comedy got more and more obscure.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm not a big fan of the Professor Crump movies, which is, I don't remember what they're called. It's about the guy who's overweight, but.
Oh, yeah. I know what you're talking about.
So,
I can't think of the name.
Yeah,
of
so.
But I know exactly what you're
talking about. But the last thing that I remember with Eddie Murphy.
Nutty Professor.
The last thing, I thought it was cool and all. You know, I remember it, but it didn't capture me. The last thing that Eddie Murphy did that captured me was Coming to America.
Fantastic movie.
Yeah, that's amazing.
That movie makes me laugh just to say Coming to America. You know what I'm saying? That's when you know it's a funny movie. When you start laughing just by saying Coming to America.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
It's a great movie. I watched that movie. I watched it again recently.
Yeah, it's awesome.
You know, it's got some artwork in it. It makes it, I watch it partially because I have nostalgia with it. I watched it when it came out, you know, and that, but plus it's one of those Christmas movies that is not a Christmas movie.
Okay.
It falls into that. Like if you watch it around Christmas time, it's great, you know, because it's during winter and, you know, like Trading Places is a Christmas movie that is not a Christmas movie either.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember that one.
So,
too.
So why was I talking about,
Oh, and by the way, you were talking about Bruce Springsteen.
Yeah. Bruce Springsteen.
My cousin, Cindy Mizell. Oh. Just came off tour with him for the last couple of years. She's a background singer she's been on the Rolling Stones, Steel Wheels tour. She worked with Chaka Khan. She just came off the road with Bruce Springsteen after about 2 years. She's worked with, she's on tour now with Steely Dan. So these people, like my cousin when I was a teenager, was already doing this kind of stuff. So, like we were talking about before we started taping, like as far as like what inspired me, there was people in my family. My cousin, while I was a teenager, an aspiring singer, and I'd be seeing her on Arsenio Hall singing backgrounds for people, or BET singing backgrounds for people. You know, and my brother Miles was a performer. He's passed on now. He was doing Broadway, not on Broadway, but like shows like Ain't Misbehaving and stuff like that. Shows that had been on Broadway, but he would do the traveling cast. So he'd be going all over the world and doing shows like that.
He was your brother, like from the same household?
Yeah, same mom and dad.
Your brother. Okay,
yeah, man. Yeah. True. My blood brethren.
Yeah, because you know, I call people brother.
Yeah, because everybody feels like that. Most people I know.
There was when I thought about having you on, I thought about having you on before tonight, like weeks ago, you know, and I just got to go through the queue. And so I think I reached out to you, but I'm not sure if I did, or I'm not sure if you got it, or I'm not.
I don't remember.
And
I might have been depressed. Be like, I don't feel like talking to nobody.
I would totally understand you, you know. I think people need to be more less alarmist and more honest about these kinds of things, these kinds of mood swings. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong. If you told somebody, "Look, I have a fever," they would be, "Oh, okay,
absolutely,
cool." If you're like, "I just don't feel it right now. I feel sad," and like, they should be the same thing.
Absolutely.
You know, like we're perfect or something, right?
Absolutely.
Anyhow, I don't mean to talk about that. You were telling me about... I was just talking about
like how my cousin and my brother and people like that.
Oh, yeah. So yeah. When I thought about that, I thought... I don't know if it would be a waste of time for you or not, but I did think about talking... One time we had a conversation when you were talking about where you used to think very differently. You know, and I don't think it's a very popular way to think anymore. I don't even think that... But I'm not sure. I don't think that it's popular even outside of circles that I'm not in anymore. But when you were, like when you had your dreads, when you're growing your dreads out and you were hanging out with certain people and you had certain types of teaching, you know, I don't know if you would want to talk about that or not, or if it's too much to talk about.
You and I have had so many of those conversations. Like in other words, I have learned to be brief.
Okay, very good, yeah. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. So yeah, those things, because, you know, it's part of a journey.
I'm about to take my hat off.
Oh, that's cool, man.
We're going now.
Oh, that's cool. No, we don't have to. We don't have to.
Okay, I got it. Hey.
It depends on whether you think you think it would be productive or not.
What part? What do you want to talk about?
Like, for example, no, but seriously, if you think it'd be relevant, we could do it. If not, if you're like, nah, that's not very useful, we don't have to talk about it. But okay, so we could be brief about it. If it's not useful, we can be brief about it. But like, it was when I think you were in Atlanta. Mm-hmm. Right, you're hanging out in Atlanta, and there was things are, have been racially charged in America forever, basically.
Yeah.
You know, for the existence of this country, mm-hmm. you know. And so you were on one side of that, and you were being hanging around with people who were maybe like, you know how people say Muslim?
Yeah.
They don't like, not like Muslim. They say Muslim.
Yeah. You know, so. Not a Muslim, but a Muslim.
Yeah.
Muslim. Muslims are Muslim. In the East.
Oh, okay.
Muslims okay. in the West.
Okay.
We're in the West.
All right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it was just, you know what, in a brief, mm-hmm. when you are black or white, mm-hmm. and you're growing up in America, a lot of times you are having identity crisis about things you're seeing on the news, about fights that are happening in school, about conversations that are happening amongst your black friends or your white friends. So we gravitate to these groups. You know, some of these groups, even the white side and the black side, can be racially charged. Like, it could be like a group, you might be 16 and you're in a group that's like promoting white pride. You might be 16 and you might be in a group that you came to that was about talking about black pride. Or like, oh, Jesus Christ, there was no African people that knew what Jesus was. That's something that was put on you through slavery. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And of course, the science of that is true. I mean, if you go and you look up slavery and the religions of the areas where my ancestors came from, there was no religious deity.
In the Americas, too.
And here, too.
South America, yeah. Native Americans.
Absolutely, mm-hmm. right? Now, that name Jesus, I think, has a lot of power for me these days. You know what I'm saying? But not in a religious way. Like, I think it's just powerful. Like maybe the universe gave us that name. Like, maybe it's like abracadabra or something, like, or possessed me. It might have, like, some power, mm-hmm. you know? So I'm like the prodigal son. I left that name when I was in these kinds of groups you're talking about. I left that name far behind. I was like, oh, please, you know, that's some slavery stuff. And then now I'm, like, looking at it in a different way. I'm not trying to say I got to believe this man died on the cross and bled and all this. But I was like, maybe God gave us that name. Maybe the universe itself, maybe it was given to us by divine sources. How, like, when we saw Moses being given on the Ten Commandments, mm-hmm. you know. But still, the commandments, they're still coming from divine sources. There's fire coming down on mm-hmm. the side of the mountain, you know. So I'm thinking that some of these names are given to us divinely. So the point is that you wind up being in an identity crisis, mm-hmm. and you are looking for something to identify yourself, you know. And so black and white people, you know, as we're coming of age, you know, we move into these groups. And then you wind up being like me, growing past these groups. Mm-hmm. I mean, my God, my circle is so mixed now. Mm-hmm. You know, I've had white roommates and everything. Back then, what you're talking about, I wouldn't even want to have even lived with somebody that wasn't black.
On the same block.
You know what I'm saying? I wouldn't even want to have dated somebody that wasn't black, yeah. you know, yeah. because it was just like I was so caught up in my own head of what mm-hmm. that means, or what the people I'm hanging around with, that's going to mean to them. Like, oh, he ain't dating black people no more. Mm-hmm. You know, but that's not true. I mm-hmm. love people. Mm-hmm. All people. You know, all colors, all races are beautiful, attractive, sexy, gifted, mm-hmm. talented. So, you know, I'm not in these kinds of groups anymore, but I still build and have ciphers with black and white people who want to talk about these kinds of things. Because it's not just black people that I talk about. The stuff that you're talking about as far as these little groups. Mm-hmm. Oh, me and my white brethren, we sit around and talk about this stuff and keep it real mm-hmm. with a group of my black brethren. Like, we don't have like black conversation and white conversation anymore. Mm. We just talk. Sometimes people get offended. Sometimes I get offended. Sometimes you wind up maybe getting the voice a little loud. You know what I'm saying? By the time that cipher is over, we're like, all right, brother, I love you. I'll see you tomorrow. Mm. You know, I didn't necessarily agree with what you said, but hey, that's okay.
Yeah.
That's where I am nowadays.
So most of the people that I end up being close to are people who have grown past those kinds of things.
Yeah, you
and
know
they
what
end
saying.
Up like exactly in your exact words, how you said, you're a resident of the universe. Yeah, you're a person of the universe.
Absolutely.
Because you grow past that and you see that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just funny. So when you get to that place and you, you look in a way, you're kind of, you have a bird's eye view of the whole situation. Mm-hmm. And a lot of it looks ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
Like these fights about race and where you're from. And,
yeah, man.
You know, and because the borders erase for you and all these lines erase for you, you know, in ways that are very rational and very sane. You know, it's not like you do realize that there's a difference between people's skin and how it reacts to sunlight and mm-hmm. whatnot, but that's the extent of it,
mm-hmm.
you know, and it doesn't mean anything else. You do realize that people are physiologically made different, men are made differently than women,
right.
And there's a reason why men are loggers and women are not. You know,
yeah,
it's like,
yeah.
And then women might be like, "Fuck you, I can be a logger too." It's like,
right.
Give it a shot. You know,
yeah.
Like, you know, you might get there in like 100,000 years.
Yeah,
of some evolution happening there. You know,
I got more melanin in my skin than you. You know, we've had the whole melanin conversation in the past.
Yeah,
you know about different things.
I think it's funny. Yeah, it's a funny thing. You know, I hang out. I come from a Hispanic culture, but in white culture, hanging out where I live now and where I've lived for the past like 15 years. It's funny how often people mention the color of their skin in white culture. Like, oh, you're so dark. I'm not dark. Look how dark I am. Like,
oh,
that's so tan. Oh my God, you're so dark. You're tan. You know?
Wow, that's funny.
It is funny. It makes me laugh.
And the opposite of that is like down south, a lot of black people. I mean, you know, a lot. We've gotten over a lot. But when I was coming up in the 70s, you know, a lot of black people wanted to be lighter.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so. You wouldn't have a dark a person that had more melanin in their skin, a darker skin brother or sister, right, going around saying, "Look how dark I've gotten." You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They more so would be trying to like stay in the house until nighttime came, so that they wouldn't be out in the sun again. Now I remember this stuff, so anybody hear this and be like, "What's he talking about?" I know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. I grew up in the black neighborhood, all black people. 360 degrees with a Hubble telescope, black people, right? And I have a friend who's Indian, East Indian, and he said his and you know, East Indians can be very dark.
Mm-hmm.
He used to tell me, he told me his grandmother used to call him out in Trinidad, said, "You better get out that sun, you're going to get black, you're not never going to get a wife." You know, so yeah. I think it's kind of like any place where there were slaves.
Mm-hmm.
Those kinds of places,
yeah,
I think deal with that kind of stuff more, like complexion and color, and thank God you grow up and you know. And
yeah,
like,
it's changed a little bit. It's changed a little bit over the years. Like the very dark skin has become beautiful again.
Absolutely,
you know, and it's always been, you know, it's all like
absolutely
like anything else, you know. And,
right.
And Bowie falling in love with Iman,
and then still married, too.
Yeah. And
they're
Grace
awesome.
Jones coming out, you know, Grace Jones.
Love her.
Yeah, she's a character. She's an amazing woman.
Oh, 2 years ago, she was doing something for the Queen, her birthday, and Grace Jones, who's probably about 60 now, she had on, of course, like a bathing suit or something
made
like that.
Of steel.
Okay? And she's hula hooping the whole time she's singing. For 3.5 minutes.
Wow.
And she never stopped it, dropped it. She's singing My Jamaican Guy. And she's hula hooping her. How Grace.
Yeah, that is
how Grace.
I gotta see that.
You
gotta That's fantastic.
See that.
Yeah.
She's bad. Yeah. I love her.
Oh yeah.
Uh oh. So I gotta cut this phone off. I meant to cut it off.
So you know, when I met you, I met you as a fan. I gotta give a little background here. Okay. There's people who don't live around here who will listen to this. And they don't live anywhere near here, you know, and will watch or listen to this, whatever they're doing, because it's available in audio and video. Okay. But, you know, I went to this club in this city that I wasn't too familiar with. The city seemed promising, but it wasn't. And I'll tell you, we can get into why, but it doesn't really matter. But I went to this place and it was called the Voodoo Lounge.
Yeah, mine.
Okay, and it was on a Sunday. And I just happened to go there. Somebody told me to go there. I don't know what. I don't know. Maybe I saw a flyer. I don't know. But I went there.
A flyer on the floor. With my foot, with somebody's foot went over my face.
I was like stepping on this flyer. I was like, what the fuck? It's like, you know,
what you this came looks in dope.
No. Yeah, so I got there, and it was like nothing. I've never seen anything like that ever again in the city. Hmm. And it was like nothing I've seen. It was not like nothing I saw in LA or in Dallas even. Mm. And when that, like, so I went there, and if you can imagine, like, it gave me the same feeling that the Good Times painting
wow. gives me.
You know that painting yeah. in the beginning? And I wish I could tell you the name of the artist. I have it in here, but I don't want to look at it.
No, I'm talking about the man on that painting.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it gave me the same feeling. That's what it looked like to me when I walked in there. I was like, wow, awesome. This is, and it was like multicultural.
Absolutely.
And so we're talking about here, you know, mm-hmm. where things are very segregated, mm-hmm. right to this day, yep. things are very segregated. And I'm like, oh, this is amazing what's going on in here. Intense. And in the back, there was booty music, is what I call it anyway.
It was hip hop. Brother therapy.
You know, that's what it sounded like. You know, it's like, hip hop back there in the back and then music in the front. And then there was a balcony.
It was fantastic. Beautiful girl, beautiful mm-hmm. guys, mm-hmm. everybody getting along.
Yeah.
Black strong people, drinks. Strong drink. You know,
cheap cover.
Oh my God!
There was a cover.
There was cheap covers, and mm-hmm. trust me, Michael and Brian, they were the mm-hmm. owners. They had this thing down where they had that the women. There were two lines: women. Even if you came with a date, you better kiss her and go to the boy line and the girl. And so they'd be giving the women roses sometimes. Huh. They would let the girls in free, depending on what the thing is. So all the brothers were kept coming because the women were getting treated so. Mm-hmm. proper that they mm-hmm. kept coming that so all the men kept coming. And let me tell you, you want to get kicked out of voodoo like fast, you let some female go up to a bouncer or one of the owners and say some guy grabbed her butt or did something. Let me tell you something, the vibe in that place was so cool mm-hmm. that they didn't even ask no questions. They wouldn't be like, listen, she said you did this. Soon as she said it, you would see these big guys dragging your behind up out of that club because they were like, it was almost like we were like, we don't do that here. You know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. like we would, everybody would be shocked. Like, oh my God, he actually did that. Or somebody almost started a fight in here. We don't do that in here. You know, it would be like the whole audience felt like that. Like, that's yeah. not what we do here. Like, mm-hmm. get them up out of here. Like, mm-hmm. what? It was awesome.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
That was Aerial Tribe. Shout out to Aerial Tribe.
Yeah.
Oh, wait, I'm going to say their names.
Yeah.
Jesse Cruz, Jared May, and we had a lot of different drummers. I have to say Josh Green. That was one drummer. Ryan Leroy, that was another drummer. I've been through more drummers than I think any other instrument.
I think that's common in a group, in a band.
Really?
Yeah. I think it's common in bands.
Ooh, drummers and me be having so. It.
Yeah.
Sometimes.
You know, so the other time that I went to the Voodoo Lounge, yeah, man, the other time that I went to the Voodoo Lounge, you were there. Another very memorable time was you were there with Britt.
Bat's all.
How do you say Britt's last name?
Britt Trainum.
Trainum.
And his lovely wife, Lady Daisy.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
And I love them.
Yeah, she wasn't performing with you guys.
Okay.
But you guys were doing Spoonie.
Yeah.
And it's an album by Britt Trainum.
Yeah.
And
me and Brother Britt, we wrote those songs together, and he produced the music, and he wrote some songs. I wrote some songs.
It's brilliant stuff, together. Man.
Oh,
brilliant
God, stuff, listen man. To, I listen to
like,
that CD.
Yeah, I can't believe that. I just, there's some music out there, like him, his work with Daisy and Heavenly Noise.
Mm-hmm.
It's some of my personal favorite work, you know, mm-hmm. and so some of the stuff on Spoonie, you know. And I just can't believe that it's not, maybe it is, and I just don't recognize it, but
it's
I just can't
what?
Believe that it's not more ubiquitous, more popular than it. For example, I'll tell you what, I used to talk to people about Spoonie and Heavenly Noise around here for years, right? And then they would check it out or whatever, and they'd just be like, it's all right.
Hmm.
I was like, how can you, what's wrong with you? It's like, how can you think that? You know, it's like, and you know, I was just like, people just got different tastes.
Yeah. I don't like everything.
No, I understand that. But you know, there's just some stuff like, this is very creative work. Like, this is really creative work right here, you know? And, you know,
but it still is. You know, in other words, like the stuff that I don't like, it doesn't mean it's not creative. I think it's like fingerprints, you know. I think, you know, or eating by your blood type.
Mm-hmm.
You do what I'm
you
saying?
You believe in that stuff?
Well, I haven't done enough research to know if it's true, because I don't even know what my blood type is. But I've heard of that type of stuff, and so maybe that's how the vibes inside of us. Maybe certain keys, certain melodies, a person's voice, just like it is not making your atoms turn faster.
Yeah, and I gotta tell you what. Yeah, and I gotta tell you what. Yeah, you're right, man. I see that. I see what you're saying.
Like Shaka Khan making my atom turn like quick, like I'm almost disappearing. You know?
Oh wow,
yeah,
that's
absolutely.
Deep, right? Yeah, the first thing that comes to my mind with Shaka Khan is like, you know, that song is so great, man.
Yeah, that's a cool song.
Yeah, it's such a great song. And So there, I have to admit that my taste in music, the stuff that I tend to like, is pretty peculiar for the standard. And it usually has been for the standard of what's going on right now. And it's not for the sake of being peculiar. It's just, that's just what I dig and that's what I vibe with. And you know, like, there's certain pieces of Mozart that I like a lot. And I could listen to those songs. It's some of the most beautiful music to me, you know?
Yeah.
And rarely do I meet somebody who will be like, that's my favorite classical song.
Yeah.
It's not the most well-known classical song, but it is utterly beautiful, you know, to me. And I'm like, how can this not be beautiful anyway? I don't know.
I have a favorite classical song, but I'd have to hum it and you'd have to tell me the name of it.
Okay.
Okay.
Man, you know what? I think that's Carmen, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, it is.
It is.
You're right.
It's Carmen.
Yes.
I'm surprised I know that.
Yeah, I love that song.
Yeah, there's so much classical music out there. I'm not a classical music fan. I know the popular stuff. I know Tchaikovsky and Carmen and Carl Orff. You know, I haven't dug too much into like all the like other stuff because you know, really, a lot of it is the same. Like to me, I'm like, oh, okay, this is kind of more or less, you know. And then, I'm not into it enough to pay attention to the nuances. Like, well, he used the violins like this, and that's the difference. And this guy used the cellos like this, whatever.
So you feel like Bach and Beethoven kind of have the same flavor?
No, man, Bach is very unique because of his counterpoint. Bach is like very rigid in a way.
Okay.
You know, he's very like, dum, 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 dum. No, that's not Bach. Is that an invention? I think it is. You know, or the way his bass notes are going with his melody notes, and it's very.
Okay.
So he's about playing with the notes.
Got you.
You know, whereas like who's the other guy you mentioned? Beethoven.
That's it. Oh yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Beethoven. He's more playing with emotional melody, I think.
Okay.
You know, because he's more singing with the music.
Okay.
Than the other dude.
Got you.
You know, and I appreciate both of them. You know, for their reasons. You know, one of my favorite composers though is Mozart, and for somebody like looked down on me and when I was going to school for music, somebody was like, for liking Mozart so much because they said he was like the pop artist of the classical world. You know, and I'm like, but it's just stuff is so great.
When does it get to be pop? When it gets popular? Like, let's say you're playing right now. I'm seeing you playing all over town, these street corners and beautiful bars. And I see you've been getting some gigs too, some good gigs where people are flying you places. That's why you're up in a bad hotel. And then about 2 years ago, I saw some pictures.
Oh, no, they didn't fly me there, but they...
you got there, though. Yeah, that was a nice room.
Oh, yeah, it was a nice room.
But, you know, in other words, so all of a sudden,
you
on Jimmy
Fallon. You got to get in with a gay crowd, bro.
Is that what it is?
the gay crowd got money. They got money.
I love everybody.
Over here in Avondale. What's up? Rainbow colors.
Hey. Yeah. But what Pink. I want to say, like, what if you did become, next thing you know, you're on the Letterman show or you're on Jimmy Fallon or something. So, hey, but you're singing the same songs you've been singing to us for years.
Yeah.
So, have you sold out? Are you pop now?
Yeah.
Like,
that's
you know, right. how did that work?
Yeah.
Like, man, I wrote this song years ago when I was playing this for people in Jacksonville. And now it's, you know, it's out here. So now I'm selling out. I'm pop. Please.
Yeah.
I can't
it's a whole, like, the whole industry thing is, I see it right now, like, the industry thing, like a building that is on fire and it's just, like, crashing down. It's, like, parts of it are just, like, people are running away from it, like, screaming. They don't know what's going on. It's chaos, you know? Like, people who are independent, they don't know if they can make money, and other people are making a bunch of money as independent, and then the record companies are trying to get in the way of the streaming companies, and the streaming companies are, you know, pretty much buckling for the record companies. So,
yeah, of course.
Like, I'm telling you, the people, one beef that I have with my fellow man in our modern society is that I think people... either through no fault of theirs, they don't have time or whatever, you know, and a privilege of mine, you know, or they do have time and they're just not doing it. They're not paying attention to the constant coups that corporations do on people and us. They're too focused on the government alone, you know, especially libertarians. They're like government this and government that. But if a company and a corporation is in control of something that you need to live a meaningful life, they're the government. It doesn't matter what you name it.
Right.
You know?
Right.
You need some water. It doesn't matter if it's a private company.
Right.
Or the government. Mm-hmm. Like, I need some water, I need phone, internet. You
right.
Know? So in music, the big record companies, they're influencing and basically buying the streaming companies. I don't have a Spotify account. I've never even once.
I don't have one.
The FBI knows. I've never even once opened a
That's
Spotify
because you're good.
On my
you don't
computer
have a Spotify
or phone.
Account because you're good. That's why you don't have one.
Yeah, I appreciate the compliment, man. You know, I work as hard as I can, and I don't work as hard as I'm able to because, you know, I have to give this disclaimer that it may sound like a cop out, you know, but there's other things, other responsibilities that I have in my life. You know, if I have to fill my basket of living, so to speak, with things, it has to be balanced, you know, and I honestly don't know that I would be happy as a dude and constantly in hotel rooms, and especially now away from my kids,
right.
And, you know, I just, what is like, it's not even worth it. You
Isn't
know?
That something, brother?
Yeah. Right now I feel like a wealthier than Bill Gates or the guy who had owned Mac.
I'll receive you completely.
Because,
you
know, I get to be around my family
right.
a lot, you know? Yeah,
exactly.
But they don't pay for that.
Right.
Nobody, you know, maybe I'm producing this positive thing in the society for the future with children and this just living, staying out of the way in this this type of expression, you know, but it's not something that's valuable to a market, you know?
Yeah. Well, you know what, brother? In my mind, the music industry, as you were saying that, you were talking about how the record companies are not what they were. And the Bible says it clear. God came down on Egypt so the Hebrews could be free. The Hebrews are the artists that, you know, Egypt is the record company. God came, it's coming down on them so that people can be free. And not have to think that they got to be signing up contracts and stuff to go and be artistic in Egypt. Do it yourself. Now it's getting so flooded. The only part that's not good is like, the good part about record companies, they have money to promote you. So let's say you and I
Why and they have the connections.
Yeah, and the connections.
Already.
Okay.
You just plug
already.
It in.
Already.
You just plug it right in.
You just tap right boom. In.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, that's the kind, that's good. That'll get you away from your family, from your house, from your friends, because you'll be traveling and you'll yeah. be gone, you know.
Big time.
Your baby
love
is,
by strangers.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Love by strangers. Meanwhile, your baby is like 4 inches taller than you mm-hmm. saw her mm-hmm. 4 months ago. That's what I'm saying. It's I remember years ago when I was singing backgrounds with Mariah Carrie, and we had done her promotional tour. Not a whole band. It was me, a background singer, a piano player, and her. That's how I knew she could sing, because I was with her when it was all dumbed down like that.
Yeah.
She could sing, trust me. Yeah. Right?
She's, yeah, she's tired got that
of this
talent,
industry.
Huh?
She's tired of mm-hmm. this business is what it is. Mm-hmm. You know, she only feel like putting the effort in vocally that she used to because mm-hmm. she's tired of it.
Yeah, you, I mean, you should. She should get tired of it.
She's tired as hell.
She might, you know, maybe she feels like being a professional chess player now. You know?
Most of them are tired as hell.
You know, I recently watched the Nina Simone documentary.
Oh, me too. Isn't it fantastic?
Oh, it's great, man. It's great. It's very moving. Very moving, man.
I love it.
She's a real powerful woman. And really, like, off the handle, really. Like, she's, you know, she stopped for 6 years. She basically said, F this. She's
mm-hmm, like,
basically,
absolutely.
You know. She basically said, I'm just tired of it. I'm just tired of music. She went to go raise her kids and she was hanging out at home. And, you know, and how can somebody not want to do that? And somebody, you know, I don't think he'll mind me saying it, but you know, Yorio?
Brother Joseph Yorio.
Yeah, okay. You know him. He's in a transitional period too. Last time I talked to him, you know, he said he wants to do a podcast too. I hope he's not too shy. But he's in transitional, like, he's been doing music his whole life. Mm. You know, and he's great.
In a band together. We've been in two bands together.
So, you know, and he's expanding. He's learning new things, you know, and he's doing new things. And I feel very similar. I always think music will always be part of my life. Like, he and I talk. Yeah, you too, right? And mm-hmm. it's like, you just, how you can't even let that go. It's like a food group, you know? But is it, for me personally, is it going to be how I sustain myself for my whole life is not a guarantee. It's not. And if it's not, it doesn't mean that I failed, you know, like if I decided to do something else, let's say I decided to start painting, or if I decided to start making t-shirts or, mm-hmm. or something more involved, you know, mm-hmm. something else, you know, woodworking. I don't know. I just thought, oh, you know, I'm really into this right now. You know,
absolutely.
You know, so
it's a life. What's wrong with that?
Mm-hmm. It's an illusion. You know? It's an illusion when celebrities used to be like Rick Moranis. You know, do you remember that dude from the Ghostbusters? He was a small, the short dude with the glasses and Ghostbusters.
If I see his face, I would.
Okay,
know.
So he was Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. He was the dad.
I know what you're talking about.
Okay, so like him, his wife got cancer. You know, unfortunately, and then she passed away, and then he quit. At the height of his career in Hollywood, he quit and he went home to raise his kids.
Wow.
Just quit. You know, and then everybody's like, whatever happened? How can you let that go? And he's like, I don't even see it like that. Look at what I got here.
Wow.
You know? Like, how can you let that go? It's like, this is nothing compared to my kids and my family, you know? Mm.
I tell you what, it's a lot of times I think it's better to never have had it. Like, it would probably have been better if I had joined bands when I graduated high school, and now we're having this interview, and I'm just like, yeah, man, I'm doing the grind, I'm trying to make it, you know what I'm saying? Than to have been in a situation where you have been on the Grammys, and you have been on the American Music Awards, you have been on Oprah, you have traveled mm-hmm. the world. I think I'm still inconvenienced recovery.
I bet.
Because that stuff was so convenient, mm-hmm. and the money was so good. Mm-hmm. And Mariah was amazing.
And it's like top level everything. Like
top
just,
level everything. Just, plus her husband was the president of the company. Mm-hmm. So I'm telling mm-hmm. you see how you used to call me over here to come mm-hmm. to the studio here? Mm-hmm. Okay, they would have sent a limo. It was that type mm-hmm. of stuff. Y'all want to come over, hang out this weekend? Talking to me and Trey Lorenz, who's still singing with her. We're still friends. Mm-hmm. And then you'd be getting limos to come and hang out at their house. Stretches. Mm-hmm. You know, so I am in convenience recovery, after all these years. That was so convenient. That was so comfortable, having a transportation to the airport, and you get to California and there's a man with a sign with my name on it. That's our driver, you know? And so that's the only part that I miss. I have my own songs now. I wouldn't trade. God asked, I was depressed one day. You know how we get. And you know, sometimes even about like dating, and you know, or the lack of, not because you can't, because you know you're shy, you're anxious, you know, or you might decide like myself that music is more important than trying to sustain that kind of relationship.
This would, which mean, is not an easy thing to do, almost never.
Are you kidding me? Not the people I know. I mean, yeah. You know what I'm saying? Please. How many girls have I had crying in my arms that I don't even know because some musician is leaving with another girl that night rather than her. And she came to the show thinking they were going to be leaving together. And I'm outside at my chest. I'm like, oh, sweetheart, come on.
Oh, wow, man.
He ain't worth it. Yeah. He ain't worth it, baby.
Yeah. You know
what I'm saying? Lying, because they'd be friends of mine and I already know what's going on. But that's the thing. I just think that's the only part. So the universe asked me, so would you trade in any of these songs that I've given you, of these seven CDs, for more sex, more intimacy, more, I mean, I didn't have to think about it. It wasn't like I had to put my, hey, give me a second. I was like, hell no. I wouldn't trade in one of my songs for more sex. I wouldn't trade in one of my songs so I can have more relationships. I mean, I have my relationships with my brethren and my sisters. And when I say that, I'm talking about my universal family.
So you wouldn't trade one of your songs that you wrote. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, or I wouldn't trade it. I was feeling depressed because I was feeling lonely.
Yeah.
So the universe said, would you trade in one of your songs to not feel so lonely? Like, I'll take some of them back and you can have like more company at night.
Yeah. I see what you're saying.
You feel what I'm saying? Yeah. Or whatever. I said, absolutely.
Yeah. You know, creative types, a lot of the time are loners. Like half the time are loners. And you know, it's a funny thing. It's a thing where you're in the public eye and you're in a situation where you are getting often attention from people. Yet there's loneliness in there. Marilyn Monroe had it. I bet you Mariah Carrie had it. I bet you Nina Simone had it.
Has it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And there you are, you know, this lonely at the top, which when saying stick around for years and years, there's usually something to them.
Absolutely.
You know, it's lonely at the top when they say
that. Absolutely. You know. Those expressions didn't just come up.
Yeah. That's why they stick, because they're real, you know.
I mean, look at it, Brother G. How many of our artists are on drugs? How many of our artists have overdosed, you know, or been in bad accidents or have gone broke? Those MTV stories and Unsung and VH1 stories, they're not making this up. This is real things. And if you watch them, you see a repetitive thing. They were a band. They were working together in the garage as teenagers. Then somebody saw them at a talent show, signed them up, gave them a bunch of money. They all got on drugs and alcohol, all started hating each other. Then the IRS came, and now they all broke. It's the same story every freaking time. So that shows me that there's a repetitive spirit in that industry that's leading people. There is something repetitive. It's just like when different people get different.
It's similar in sports. It's similar in sports industry. There's a repetitive thing there too. In boxing or in football.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
You know? It's kind of like when somebody, you know, you might have five people get diagnosed with some ailment that has the same name. And the doctors can tell you, now, you're probably going to be experiencing, you know, dry mouth and, you know, you'll have a little pain in your right arm. They got specific arm even. In your left arm, you're going to feel this. You know what I'm saying? That's the industry. There is some repetitive ailment that is going on in my mind in that industry, that everybody that gets in it without some kind of true guidance, meaning somebody that did it before them, that's in their family, that did it successfully. If you just getting picked up because you're a garage band and somebody say, I can make y'all rich, you're going to be on VH1. You're going to be on Unsung.
Yeah.
You know, where are they now? You know, hopefully you didn't destroy yourself so much where you could at least go and work in Europe. You know, can make some money.
You know who you would appreciate? I appreciate him very much. Is Paul Stanley from the lead singer of Kiss. He's the lead. The lead singer
of Kiss. You mean the one with his tongue out all
the
time?
No. Everybody always thinks that's the guy. But he is, man, I can't think of his name right now. I know it's Gene Simmons.
Okay.
He's Gene Simmons. True. But Paul Stanley, he's a lead singer.
I know who you're talking about now.
And that guy is a really interesting guy because he's been through the whole thing and he's kept a level head and he's all these people have fallen apart around him. And the guys from Aerosmith, too, they've kept their head together, too, in all this decadent, you know, rock stardom, you know. And
I mean, they've been through it.
You know, trying to include something in this of that is kind of, it's just like a big thing. It's a big thought. It's a big thought to me is that this is, well, it's foundational, is that this is a situation that we're in because it's things built on things that preceded it. And those things are based on values, and our values today, the way that life is right now, it doesn't have to be the way that it is right now. But people act like if you took another Earth and you put all the elements together and you threw it out into outer space, eventually we would happen.
Mm-hmm.
And we would end up with light and internet and whatnot. Like if this is some sort of organic, natural progression. But we're like this because of recent, powerful, wealthy people. Mm-hmm. Even if you want to talk about 2,000 years being recent.
Right.
It is.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
And the things didn't have to develop this way. You know, and mm-hmm. you know, some of... It might be a useless thought because somebody might find it a useless thought and they'll say to me, well, Goliath, well then, you know, why did it end up this way if it was not supposed to end up this way? It's just by chance, mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm. This dude named JP Morgan happened to have a bunch of money and he crashed the stock market. And, or if you want to go back before that, we can go back before that. And this dude, Columbus and his boat and the King of Spain, if you want to go back, you want to go back, we can go all the way back to Africa if you
right,
want to,
yeah, man.
You know, and so that it's one of my favorite things to hang on to in my consciousness because it reminds you that you can live however you want.
Yeah.
You know, and yeah. You have your morals too. You don't want to hurt anybody, you know, but you can change this, all this. We don't have to live this way. You
absolutely.
Know? So I'm saying all that because music as an industry, they might be like things that like eternally will be like trying to put a square peg into a round hole and you kind of make it like fit like this and it kind of fits like that,
mm-hmm.
because is music and art even supposed to be an industry? But we've built an industry around it because we have to plug ourselves into the economic system somehow, you know? And, but so saying all that,
that's, I understand.
Yeah. Saying all that, that's the way that it is, right? That's what, like, you can't change that fact. Like, in a lifetime, I don't think.
Right.
You know, without blowing something up.
Right. No, exactly. You know? No, it's true, brother. Yeah. Even I got to that point when I was living in New York and touring around, you know, like you may have heard this story before. Like, so I'm doing what I'm doing in New York, but I left Jacksonville to do after a few years, finally.
Is Chaka Khan? With Chaka Khan?
Yeah, Chaka Khan.
Mm-hmm. The legend.
My mom said she didn't want me to meet Chaka Khan.
Yeah.
Because she said, I think Chaka will destroy you.
I like that.
She did. She Chaka loved her, but she knew I loved her. Like, loved her. You know, my mom was like, wow, that's a little weird. Like, it's been a lot of years now. What is with this Chaka Khan? Mm-hmm. But she loved her, and I loved her. But anyway, so you're finally getting to do what you want to do. I'm touring. I'm on TV. My mom was seeing me before she passed and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. Brother, by the time about 3 years into that, I was doing this session for a CNC Music Factory, and you know they were doing all that. Yeah, everybody dance now and all this stuff. Can't feel the music, you know. They were doing all this dance stuff. Well, because them and Mariah was on the same label, so they were getting me background sessions on different people they were producing. They called me for this session, and I'm singing this. I tried to not do the session because I told them Chaka Khan's playing at the Apollo tonight, so I probably don't need to do this session because I'm going to see Chaka Khan. They said, listen, this session will be done long before she comes on. as the destiny has it, it would have it, all the equipment kept breaking down. We're at this session, this board's not working, this isn't working. They get it back up, okay, the mic ain't working, all this stuff. The clock was ticking.
Yeah.
By the time Dr. Gary Khan got ready to come on, I had left that session. I was like, okay, listen, I got to go.
Yeah.
So I left. In other words, I'm saying this to say there must be something that's not like, but like Brother Britt Trainum, he told me a few years ago, he said, you know, Pat, he said, I know you always think that was the dumbest thing you could have done in your career. Because
what, working with him?
No, leaving my work to go and see Chaka Khan make some money.
Oh, we're leaving to see Chaka Khan.
Leaving my session where I was singing backgrounds for the biggest producers in the industry at that time, which was CNC Music Factory. Mm-hmm. They were like one of the biggest at that time. But Chaka was playing up at the Apollo, so the equipment at this session kept breaking down.
No, I know. I got that part, but I'm saying...
He said, he knows
you should have stayed there.
Said, I always thought like I should have stayed. I would never do that
because
again.
Because you were going to go to see Chaka as a fan?
Absolutely.
Okay.
I wasn't working. I was at work. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I know, you know, I've been acquainted with her socially, so I've never told her this story, and I can't wait to tell her one day. But she would have thought that was stupid, too. Mm-hmm.
She's like, I don't know.
You a dumb motherfucker. How you gonna come see a bitch making some money? And you supposed to be making some money. You gonna come see my ass? Mm. That's how she talked. You know. Yeah. So it's like I always thought that was the biggest mistake in my career because I don't remember getting called for much work. You know that these big producers all know each other.
Yeah.
So when you do something like that,
oh wow,
people talk. The industry ain't big like that. So I don't remember working a lot. After that, right? Yeah. But guess what? So Brother Britt said, Pat, he said, I know you think that was the dumbest mistake in your career. He said, but you must have been so bored at that session going, ooh, and ah, singing background. He said, you left to go see something real. Mm-hmm. Now, I can tell you this. I remember everything about that Chaka Khan concert. I don't remember nothing about that session I was doing with CNC Music Factory.
Yeah.
Oh, I remember leaving.
Yeah.
And I remember the other two singers who that was singing on, and one of them had gone on to have more success, Rashawn Patterson. Mm-hmm. And but yeah, so that's what I'm saying. You would think I'm singing with CNC Music Factory, you know, or Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis or whoever it might have been, but it was saying, why would you know you in your dream? But it must be something that's delusional there that I would leave. To go see somebody.
Oh yeah, I could feel the delusion.
You know what I'm saying?
I could feel the delusion in it, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could feel it. Like I've been in a few situations like that where I'm like, wow, this is what it's like.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like and sure, at the end of the production, at the end of that production, it will be very polished. And they will have the best you can get in mastering the music. And it will have gone through several opinions of people who go, yeah, change that part. No, take that part out.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You'll end up with this masterpiece, you know? And, but
double still, this.
Right. But still
say the, come in right on the, and then we're going to stop.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
All the recording magic.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I don't. I'm not a fan of it. There's a reason why I don't record very often. You know,
because you don't feel like doing all that.
It's just like, here we go again. Like you got to be the engineer, and you got to be the guy who knows about the microphones. Mm. You know, you got to be the guy who's playing the instrument, and you got to be the guy who's mastering the music and mixing the music. You know, and this is just there's a reason. Why I think that music nowadays sucks more. Like there's a reason why there's more shitty music is because you have all these people trying to do this one person trying to do all these jobs, you know? And the people who get that done, they don't have any kids. And if they have any kids, they don't see their kids.
Right.
You know, or they don't see their wife or they don't see their girlfriend or whatever the situation
is. You are correct.
You know, yeah. And, you know, I've never, almost through my whole life, I've almost never wanted to be that person. I can't and being shut up in the same room all day.
Right.
I can do it.
Right.
But I need like 3 days to recover from that. You know, and there's like one of the most like uncomfortable feelings that I've had is sitting in a studio that's being paid for. You know, I'm recording for somebody else or I'm doing a session for somebody else and the clock is ticking and I've been in there and we got to get this done and we've been in there for 6 hours and I just want to get the fuck out of here right now, you know. And I don't want to wear these headphones anymore.
Yeah.
And I'm like hearing, you know, and is this even enjoyable anymore? You know, it loosely reminds me of like when you want to do something and you plan on doing something today, we're going to do this today. And then because we've been planning on doing it and then we go ahead and start execute it and everything starts going wrong and maybe we should just quit.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And you could be the person that quits and enjoys life, or you could be the person that perseveres and it possibly gets worse, or you persevere and then it turns into a nice thing. And then you're happy because you persevered.
Okay, yeah, man.
You know, but I think that either one is okay.
Yeah.
I think that either one is the same. You know?
I agree.
You know, because there's...
I agree with you.
Yeah, I'm a very flexible person. Like, if stuff starts to go wrong, I'm like, yeah, we're probably not supposed to do this right now.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and that doesn't mean we're not going to come back to it.
Right.
You know? Right. It just means that there's no reason to be uncomfortable in life. You know... something like this.
Man, I agree with you.
Yeah.
I needed to have this conversation with you.
Yeah.
You know, because...
Well, you know, other people who are real success heads, though, they'll be like, these guys are full of shit.
No, look at Nina Simone. She said, I wanted to do classical music. Nina Simone, she wanted to be the first black, as you know, female classical pianist in the United States. But the jazz thing started working for her. So like the rest of us, she started getting her hustle on, started playing jazz. But she said, years later, she said, I'm not happy. Mm. She said, I ain't happy doing this.
Yeah.
This is the opposite of what you want to hear somebody like that, this great person saying in an interview, you know. And Chaka Khan said to me once, made me
very
sad.
She said, I'm not happy?
Chaka Khan told me once, and I this was years ago, so I hope that this has changed. I hope that when she told me this, that she's not in the same place, you know. Mm-hmm. Someone that I love like I do, I hope not. But she said to me, the only time I feel really happy is when I'm singing. And I was like, the only reason that made me sad, I was like, damn, it's 24 hours in a day, you know. A concert on it, 2 hours, you know, and then you got, you know.
It's really 1 hour because you got an opening act.
You got an opening act. So Chaka Khan probably on 1 hour and 15 minutes, it's hour and a half.
Happiness a day.
And wow, but.
An hour and a half of happiness a day.
But you know what? But the years later, I started realizing that I felt the same way. Like, I was hoping that I wasn't, you know how like you can be channeling stuff from people you admire that's not really you, but you're making yourself feel like this because your favorite feel like this? Mm-mm. What she said and what I discovered for myself was not because she said it. It was because I finally understood what she was saying. Mm-hmm. Singing keeps my mind focused. I don't know if I got ADD or whatever, these little things. All these, ADD, the cure was an ass whipping when I was growing up. Mm-hmm. Like, it was black parents in the hood ain't taking their kids to psychologists and getting them on no pills. They get belts, switches to say, sit your ass down. And stop all that moving around right now.
Yeah,
ADD got cured with an ass whipping in the hood. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I think that it keeps me, like I'm singing, I always been singing all the time upstairs. I'm riding, I'll be singing riding my bike back home from the studio. Mm-hmm. You know, I go to River and sing. I'm sitting out on my back steps where I'm renting a room right now, late at night playing music. I am in a constant practice. Mm-hmm. And I don't think it's always just because I'm trying to get better. I think it's because when I'm singing, it keeps me like focused. That's why I like cleaning up trash. I know that sounds crazy, but I like cleaning up the streets.
It sounds crazy.
You know what I'm saying?
That's your white blood.
That's the McMillan side, right? Hey, but it's true. You know, I like them.
I love it.
That was the first thing I did today. I woke up, peed, and grabbed and I was out the door with bags that the city donated me from Clean It Up, Greening Up. They donate bags and gloves to me, and I have adopted Riverside Park.
See,
and I do that, and it gets my mind.
This
is
part of the volunteer work that you do. And you're volunteer work advocate, and you do it.
Yeah, I'm an advocate, and I do it.
So what do you...
You and I both, are you still singing at the hospitals?
Yeah, but what do you find so... Oh, I got to talk about that on this podcast one day. But what do you find so... Hey, baby. What's up, baby? What do you find so important about volunteering? Because it kind of pisses me off. And I'll tell you why in a little bit. If you
I'll be brief.
Yeah.
To me, it's a sight thing. Well, you know, I've done the Clara White mission, and I've done... You turned me on to... Body
James
and soul,
Jenkins.
Where we go and sing into the hospital rooms and stuff for the patients. And the cleanup part for me is a visual thing. I got so tired of walking down streets, riding my bike down streets, and seeing a bunch of trash, right?
Yeah.
And I was like, the damn city. The universe said, you got hands, and you know, and you can bend. So I've been doing this since 2012. And then, you know, somehow people find out what you're doing, and Mayor Payton gave me an award for my efforts, cleaning up Jacksonville. And,
yeah, he should have just gave you a check instead.
I would love that.
Yeah, that's my thinking. It's
I would love that.
You know, because, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
I would have spent it by now, but that probably would have been good.
This is the problem that I have with the volunteering,
okay,
is because things are not so simple in our society. And our society is, I don't care what people say, okay? Our society values people who are rich and people who have money. If you have those things, it doesn't matter who you are, what you do. Like, you will, it's your universally respect card. It's your universal respect card, meaning that you will get a nice bed and you will get called sir or ma'am, and you will get a nice car and people will treat you a certain way. And if those people won't treat you a certain way, there's like 20 more people in the room that will.
Right.
You know, and then at the same time in society, people say money doesn't matter. And they say money is not important, you know. So you see this conflict right there. Now, if I was to go cleaning up the streets, okay, I'm conscious. Now, it's a visual thing for you. I understand that, and it's a personal thing that you're doing, maybe,
it's personal.
Okay, because see, I'm like, okay, well, all these people, like the mayor, it may give you a reward, but he should really award you in how society really awards people.
You know, I would have been open to that.
Yeah, I'm just saying.
It is, you know, I'm like, still gonna
like,
do it.
Yeah,
know?
Yeah. Because I'm saying, like, if I'm doing something somewhere like that, I'm making people's property value go up.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that's great, and that's benevolent and all. But at the same time, I would still do it. I'm not saying don't do it. I'm not saying
I know.
But I would still. I'm saying that at the same time, I don't want to be naive. I want to be conscious of the fact of how things work. Like, I'll put it this way. Look, this will get me in trouble, but fuck, it's too bad. But look, like, I do work sometimes for city events.
Okay.
Okay. And nonprofits. Okay. And I change, you know, I don't mean to overplay my role, but it's an important role. I change the environment sonically. And I really changed it. I know what music does. That's what got me into music.
Okay.
That's what got me into music.
Right.
I feel, if it was not for this dude or this band playing up here, I would not be feeling how I am feeling about this place right now.
Right on.
Not even a little bit. You know?
Right on, right on.
So, but what do I get is I get, in comparison to the rest of the staff that is seen as more important in this situation, I get a small portion, a very, very... modest portion, which I'm not really complaining. I said yes.
Okay.
And, but you know, where was I going to? Oh yeah. Well, they get a much larger portion and I get a great job, Goliath.
Yeah, sure.
You know what I'm saying?
That's why it's gotta be personal.
Yeah.
You know, because like I said, I be singing all the time because Otherwise, I'm thinking about dark stuff that, you know, yeah. So I just be like, let me put on some music.
So I'll tell you what.
But that's what this cleaning up is for me, too. It keeps me focused.
Yeah. No, man, if it's therapeutic, by all means, for sure. And it's good for your for the society around you and your environment.
Well, it works like every way for me.
Yeah, yeah. The benefits, the benefits are undeniable.
Yeah, you know. And I'm moving my body, you know.
Yeah. The benefits are undeniable. Now, I'll tell you. Fortunately, I have several things that make me happy, you know, and maybe even more than music is being physically active makes me happy. Like right exercising, on. Like riding my bicycle or jogging or taking a long walk. And I get to that point where I'm fatigued.
Yeah.
I'm happy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe I'm complaining about, oh man, I'm sore right now, you know, or I'm tired of holding this up or that up but it makes me happy that night and I go to bed tired. I love going to bed exhausted, man.
Yeah,
you feel the same
you
way?
Don't stay up late like me. Well, you got a little baby anymore. You probably can't.
I used to but I just can't even do it if I wanted to.
God, I'm up so late,
you know.
I just can't go to sleep.
So the volunteering work, you know, like the people in local government, I commend you. Great job, Patrick. No.
Thank you.
No, man, but it's deep, man. It's like not everybody has the balls to do that. Like hey, this is what I need to do right now. And you're doing it, and it's public. It's a public thing. You're doing it, and
which people means people think you. I'm a homeless man on the side of the road picking up trash. Mm-hmm.
No, it doesn't have anything to do with your complexion either.
Nothing. They be thinking I'm homeless. They be stopping sometimes. People come and give me a couple of dollars. I take it.
Yeah.
You know.
We should go to the secondhand store and get the raggiest clothes they have.
Oh, I got them.
Oh, yeah. Very good. Some in there.
Or
American flag on one of them.
Well, it'll also be the people that's in your living standard range. In other words, people that's poor like you. Like the people that don't think that you're homeless. And they do. The people that also poor like yourself that don't think that you're homeless, then they'd be like, oh man, what, you're on probation? I'm like, no. You know, I just like to clean the park up. They're like, oh man, that's all right. That's all right, right? Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. So yeah, like, people have a lot of reasons why they think you're doing it. Instead
that's
of
your white blood, huh?
Please.
You know, race is a wonderful thing, man. Race is so much fun to make fun of it. Like, I make fun of it as often as I can.
Oh, please.
And people don't realize that I'm not serious. People don't realize I'm not serious. Like, some people just take it and run with it. Like,
it's hilarious.
Like some sort of torch, you know. Yeah, especially, you know, some of my wife's friends. Well, I'm like, damn, I was joking right now. that's not funny, Goliath. You can't say that kind of thing. I'm like, like moral police over here. I'm leaving this yoga class right now. I'm sorry. I gotta go. I'm leaving this meditation group. You guys, y'all.
Well, I think sometimes they may not understand your sense of humor.
Well, you know, but the thing is, when you
intellectual as sideways.
No. It might be, man. I'm sorry. It might be. You might be correct.
You know what I'm saying? So that one person will be rolling in the room with you, laughing. Who gets it? You know.
That's well, funny. That person usually tends to be the person who has left their race behind. Like I'm telling you, you know, if you were to look at my friends, right? Somebody else, will call them my white friend, my black friend, my Mexican friend, right? These group of friends, something they have in common, the person that would be rolling is the person who became a resident of the universe. Right, like they bypassed it already.
Yeah, exactly.
So if I say something, they're not taking it personally. Like how can you even identify with that?
Right.
No, you know, now, if you're trying to hurt me with your words, I'm hurt by the fact you're trying to hurt me, not because you're criticizing some group of people or me equating him with them. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, kind of like what Donald Trump has been saying about Mexican people.
Oh, man. Oh, I got to tell you.
Isn't that crazy?
No, I mean, I just ignore him. I go, you know, I get upset. This is infuriating to me. And, you know, I don't get infuriated like I'm going to punch something. I get infuriated like I'm going to create something to combat it. But it's infuriating to me in the sense, like this podcast, you know, it's infuriating to me in the sense that the news and people pay attention to it. Like, I don't mind that you mentioned it. I don't mind. We could talk about it even. but I'm not going to mention it, and I'm not going to bring him. I'm not even going to think about that mofo, because Donald, I mean, like, when there's a crazy dude on the street and he's just saying all this crazy stuff, what do you do? Like, do you, all you and all your friends turn and put all the cameras on this dude? Or do you ignore him? You ignore him.
Keep it moving.
Or you try to ignore the dude, or you walk to the other side of the street.
Yeah, man.
Because the dude's saying these belligerent things, right? But no, people like, hey, let's pay attention to this crazy dude right here. There's all these sane people saying all this sane stuff over here. But absolutely, we're going to pay attention to this. You know, and this is a disease. It's like, it's a problem in the media, and it's a problem with people. And I've advocated for years. It's like, this is my cleanup. This is my cleanup.
Gotcha.
Is I've advocated for years to for people to become media illiterate, and when you're being swindled, you know, and because it's important, because we people can look at it different ways, but we live in a society that is shady. We live in a shady society of swindlers. We are swindlers. We are a society of swindlers. From mothers and fathers that were swindlers. Because the point is, you're supposed to get one over on somebody else, or you're supposed to sell something at a higher price than what you paid for. There's always some sort of secret going on. Until that changes, then it'll be a different society. You know, but so media literacy in this kind of environment, in an environment where the posters are using colors to try to get your attention, try to smoke Camel cigarettes or cartoons, or they put a big ass on here and then your breasts and whatever to get you to do what we need you to buy or do or feel insecure. I don't know what, you know, this is the environment that we live in, you know?
Yeah, of course. It's not commercials.
I mean, it's not a motherly embracing environment that it is, like the dude is trying to trick you.
Right. Yeah. That's why I haven't had a TV for years. But when I do, if I'm house sitting for somebody or something like that, I am watching TV. Every time the commercial come on, mute. I don't want to hear it. I don't want to see it.
Very wise.
I can't stand them. It just reminds me of some kind of brain. Not that the TV show I'm watching ain't brainwashing enough.
Right.
You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But now the commercials, you know, now we done kicked it up. It, you know, the 10th power. I every single time, mute.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't miss having a TV. I go to my friends' houses when I want a little TV fix, because like Game of Thrones and stuff like that, you know.
You like that show?
That show is insane.
Oh, man.
That show. You like it?
Yes.
That show is insane.
But it's gone right now.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm hurting.
It'll be back, Brother Goliath. You just have to be patient.
And yeah, that it's show, okay. The saga is amazing. You know? I am patient, you know, but it's like, I've watched the show. I didn't watch it as it came out. Like, I didn't have that experience or luxury, really, to like, oh, tonight is the night that it comes out. I'm going to watch it tonight. I had to watch it, like, afterwards.
Oh, yeah, me too.
Yeah, so I watched it, and then the next night, I would watch another one the next night, and they would go just like that.
Yeah.
You know, like, I bought the DVDs, and, you know, and, so, and other ways that I watched it. anyway, I'm floored by the show.
Yeah. I did that with The Wire. I was like, I didn't see The Wire. And a very, very good friend of mine is the main actor on The Wire. His name is Michael K. Williams with the scar, Omar. Very good friend of mine. We were actually in a group together in New York, right? And so I kind of felt bad that I was hearing about this show, and I had never seen it. So it was probably had been off the air canceled, because it was big, right? That show did very well.
I know what it is, yeah.
You know?
Oh, yeah.
4 years later, I got me and all of my friends, we had every night for months with The Wire. You know? Fantastic.
That's fun,
show.
Yeah.
Golly.
Yeah, wow. Sure.
But Game of Thrones, I watch as it's happening. Like, I'm watching it on Sunday or whatever night it comes on. You know? Yeah, I don't get too much into the TV anymore. And I'm surprised, because, golly, that was like a drug, you know?
The Game of Thrones and The Wire?
Well, no, just TV.
It is.
It was like a drug coming up
in
my earlier years, you know? And now I'm like, I've deprogrammed to TV. But like I say, everybody, you have a little drink from time to time. You do what I'm saying? Like, that's so I go to friends' house if I want to get a TV fix. Mm-hmm. I don't want one in my house, though. And if I ever do get one in my house, I want it behind, like, they got to be wood, though. It's got to be something I can open it. Like, you just think it's a shelf or a wall.
Birthday present. You hear that, people? Birthday present for Patrick Evan.
And a house to put the TV in.
You hear that, Mayor Curry? You hear that, Mayor Curry? Stop giving these awards out and give us some cash.
Yeah, or a house. A small house. I'm talking about, like, tiny living. Mm-hmm. It can be... one square, like,
listen. The mayor should do his job for an award.
I think he should have given me a tiny house and I'll be okay.
That'd be dope, man.
A tiny house.
Like, I will do this for the remainder of me living here. You give me this tiny house, that'd be no problem. Come on. Just like,
because my whole thing is I don't need nothing big. I am a minimalist.
Me too.
I can move. If my friend Overstreet's got a van, I can move every single thing I have at one trip.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
One trip. I've been living that way for years. Yeah. Okay.
I wish I could do that. I just can't do that.
Who wants to come off tour and to, like, I saw Tom Cruise's house, or, you know, the Jay-Z and them, I'd be seeing these houses. I'm like, who is coming off tour and feel safe walking in these houses?
These big, palatial houses?
Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
I want two doors, a bathroom door, and whatever's going up under the sink, you know, like where you put your products.
Okay.
Maybe one more door, a closet. Mm-hmm. If you're not, I'm going to walk in my house off too. I want the house to be so small. Mm-hmm. I'll be like, if you ain't here and you're not under the sink or in the bathroom.
Only midgets can attack you.
Yeah, like, you. I know you can't be in here. You got to be in the sink, under the sink. Or the bathroom. That's what I'm saying. I want to be able to check my joint out as soon as I walk up in a spot. I am not getting ready to go check out 8 bedrooms. Mm-hmm. I was in a mansion once. It had 11 bedrooms. This guy used to manage New Kids on the Block. 11 bedrooms. Mm. And would you believe sometimes the bathroom didn't work in certain floors? Like, oh, you think it's a mansion.
Yeah.
They'd be like, oh, no, don't go to that one. You got to use it. I'm like, you got this house and you got a bathroom that don't work? Yeah. Really?
Plumbing went bad.
It's the same, like everybody else out. Mm-hmm. You feel what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. The plumbing went bad. You got to get it fixed. It's like, it's all these illusions. Like, you know, it's like making a bunch of money. It's like heaven. Mm-hmm. Nah, it's not heaven. I think there's a friend of mine's mother told me years ago, Brother Goliath, she said, Patrick, you know, a true security is not what you have. She said, it's what you're willing to give up. I went right and running for my journal because I didn't want to forget that, and I never have.
A true security.
She said, true security is not what you have. It's what you're willing to give up. Mm.
I see that.
I can see that. I can see that. And if somebody didn't see it, I wouldn't be telling them, you crazy. You got to see what I'm saying. Mm. Or what she said. Mm-mm. I get anybody.
Like what you can go without.
What you can go without and still feel sane. Like what you were saying about the music industry. Like, damn, I'm fixing to, like, go on the road for like 8 months without my baby and my wife. Mm-hmm. Really?
Yeah.
You know, even this little one I'm living with now, he's five months old, my friend's baby. Now, it's not that I wouldn't go if I got called to go to Japan, because, you know, I'm helping out a little bit, you know, babysitting and doing that kind of stuff. It's not that I wouldn't help out. I mean, it's not that I wouldn't go to Japan if I got called. I got a passport. I'm ready. But I would be in Japan going like, wow, by the time I get back, he's going to be so much bigger. And he's not even my biological seed, you know. Mm-hmm. So I can imagine how I would feel if it was like my kid. I'd be really thinking like, oh my God, I'm caught between my career and seeing my son grow up. I don't want to come back and he's taller than this table.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You do what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So.
I have very strong feelings about that. Like, in my personal perspective of my life. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know how people in the military go away for like 6 months. I don't care what you're doing. I don't care what you're doing over there. They're a different person than I am. I'm like, you need to court-martial me. I'm going to go to jail for a little while because I'm staying home.
Okay.
You know, and it's not, people might think it's extreme, you know, but what's more extreme than, you know, getting in an airplane going 4,000 miles per hour, like for 5,000 miles that way, you know, I'm kidding, but
I wish you could teleport yourself.
Yeah, that'd be great.
I would love that.
Mm-hmm. I'm reading a novel right now where there's some teleporting going on. It's called, it's a science fiction novel. I don't know if you like to read this kind of stuff, but it's Hyperion. It's the first real, like, sci-fi fantasy novel I ever read. And it's really good. If you ever want to read it, you should totally read it. They're not paying me for that or anything, though.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, why would you read it if you ain't getting paid?
No. No, I mean, they're not paying me for to say that. I would love to get paid to read. That would be great.
And I would love for the city of Jacksonville to give me a tiny house. So I'm going to work on getting you paid to read, and maybe you can help me work on getting the city to donate me a tiny house. Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think you deserve it.
Well, I would love to have it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I call Jacksonville the Jupiter of America because land-wise, it is the biggest city in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
So I call it the Jupiter of America. And so I say it's a big city. I just would like to, I like feeling like I'm doing something for the city. I'm already broke in it. So, you know, I used to be like thinking, one day when I'm very successful, I'm going to do a lot of things in the community. No, you're not. You're going to be traveling, and then you're going to do what I saw people in the industry doing. Okay, now, tomorrow we got a benefit for this park for these kids.
Mm-hmm.
And you show up all made up, of course, hair did, nails did. You know, I've seen all this, right? And you never go back to the park until it's time for the camera to be there again. But what I was told as a citizen of the universe is if you start doing it now, then by the time you get into these realms, you will already know what it feels like.
But if you start doing all those things.
Cleaning up, going to declare white missions, singing in hospitals like you and I do, you know, that kind of stuff. If you are already in tune to doing that, then when you got a hit record out, you'll be like, yeah, like tomorrow I'm going to go and sing at the hospital, you know, for some people. Or tomorrow I'm going, I don't give a flip if the cameras are there. Well, no, ain't no cameras there now unless somebody catch me, you know. Somebody be catching me sometimes and they'll, you know, do a little story or something like that. But I'm doing this without cameras. I'm doing this with people at work. I'm not waiting until I feel more financially successful to start deciding that I'm going to start doing community service, which is how I used to think.
Mm-hmm.
The guy was like, doing that? What you doing? Why you just sitting here? You don't have a gig this afternoon. What are you doing? Go clean up the park.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I found money sometimes. I found a $50 bill on the north side one time. Yeah.
That was mine,
up.
Bro.
Huh? That was yours? Mine, yeah. You wasn't over there. Yeah, well, yeah,
I bet you looked just like my $50 bill.
No, I was in the hood doing it at this time. Yeah. I don't think that was your money.
That's where I dropped it. Right
there. I remember I kept thinking, God, at least somebody mama going to tear their behind up because I'm sure that mama probably gave them that money and say, go to the store and get me some cigarettes.
Mm-hmm.
Some beer. You better bring me back my change, right? And it dropped that money, and I'm cleaning up over off Kings Road, and I found it. I was like, okay, I said, okay, this is a guy giving me a little gift. I found money in the park, in Riverside Park.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, every now and then I get paid. It just might not be as much as, you know, a sanitation worker, you know. But, yeah, I get little jewels and gifts dropped on me sometimes. And when people come by and just say thank you, just random people I don't even know. They don't know if I'm homeless. They don't know if I'm doing probation activities. But when they do come by walking their dogs and they just say, thank you. What? You know, that word thank you to me probably as powerful as people would consider Jesus to be. Thank you. That means a lot.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. You know, so it just depends. I guess I'm not expecting as much out of life as I used to be. So little things like clean up a park or thank you or all these little things, I guess I'm just like, I'm not expecting what I used to expect anymore. Whatever gifts come, I just roll with it and I say thank you to the universe. You know. Oh, That was right on time, huh? That was yeah. God's bill.
Is that we have to finish?
We need to.
Yeah, yeah.
I have to go to my gig.
You know, I was slightly towards the end here, just a little bit distracted because I'm like, there's a frozen frame over here.
Is it on still?
Yeah, it's still on. But all right, we gotta go. You know, it was wonderful having you on.
It was fantastic.
Yeah, I'm glad you did this, and I think you're gonna love it. The results, and
I love the conversation.
All right, but great.
You and I always have enjoyed getting together and talking.
That's why I knew this would work.
You know, without mics, yeah. without cameras, oh, yeah. this is what we do but, when yeah, we get together.
Oh yeah,
you know
but people, this is the kind of conversation though that you don't have with everybody. And part of the reason that I do a podcast like this is because so people can model, so there's models for it,
right? Obviously,
you see, and it's a place where people who are like-minded can get some of this when they can't get it,
right?
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
Because oh man, I want to hear, I love hearing them talk, you know, because I want to be in that conversation, and that's what I would have thought, and I would thought I never looked at it that way, yeah, you know, man. All this kind of stuff. All right, it's great having you on.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here. I appreciate you, man. Friend.
I hope you're not really frozen in this frame right here, but I think it's going to work here.
Awesome.